inculcation of good reading habits, and this topic is especially meant for those learners who are learning English as a second language. As you know that those who are using language fairly well, they have got a number of different abilities, like they are able to they listen to the radio, speak to the neighbors, read a magazine, write letters. In this way, we can say that we are using four language skills. These skills are listening, speaking, reading, and writing. Now let us think about the two skills, speaking and writing skills. When a language user using speaking skill, he or she is producing sounds, words, sentences. In this way, a production is involved from the user's point of view. In the same way, when a user is writing, he is writing words, he is writing sentences, he is writing paragraphs. So in both the skills, speaking and writing, from the user's point of view, production is involved. And therefore, we say that these skills are productive skills. The speaking and writing skills are productive skills. Now let us see the two different skills, listening and reading. When we listen to someone, as you are listening to me at present, when we listen to the music, when we listen to the TV news, listen to the radios, listen to any music, so we get information from there. Listen to the news, we are getting news. We are listening to someone, we are getting some information. Means the user is receiving something here. In the same way, when we are reading a novel, reading a textbook, reading a newspaper, the user here is receiving something. It means listening and reading, these are receptive skills. Means we can categorize these four skills, listening, speaking, reading, and writing, into two main groups. And these are productive skills. Speaking and writing are productive skills, whereas listening and reading are receptive skills. Now we decided to discuss reading skills. But see, whenever a user is using language, he or she is using a combination of skills here. Like a participant in conversation, he is not only listening, but he is also speaking. Means two skills are involved. Today we are going to discuss about the reading skills. Now let us talk about what is reading. As we know that we can say, what is reading? Reading is a receptive skill. Reading is a receptive skill because the user receives here something. We can say that it is a process of recognizing printed or written symbols. Like this, I am reading here, I have to recognize the words or written symbols. Now, number of activities are involved here. Number one, the interpretation of symbolized or written or printed matter, how the sentences are written and what is their meaning. Written and printed symbolized matter. Number of things are involved here, like involve the habit of accuracy in recognizing words. What are these words? Like here it is do, do, not, not, like this. We have to remember the span of recognition, how many words we can recognize at a span, the number of words we can recognize in a span. It helps us to read faster. So the span of recognition is very important, and this can be developed through the continuous reading. means the rate at which words and phrases are organized, recognized. When we recognize some words and phrases in a written format, we can utter or produce more number of words in and we can develop a faster reading. Number of times we see that when the student is reading line number one, and after that he missed the line number two and comes to the line number three. It means we need accurate returnship of eyes from end of one line to the beginning of the next line. This is very important skills which can be acquired with the help of a regular reading habits. Reading is very important because it requires one to think, feel and imagine. So we cannot say that reading is a simple process. It is a very complex process. As we know that we have to recognize printed and written symbols. We have to remember the span of recognition, the rate at words and phrases are recognized, accurate returnship from the end of one line to the beginning of the new next line. And here the interpretation of ideas symbolized by the written or printed, we have to interpret that. And most important thing is it requires to think, feel and imagine. Now, why reading? Why this skill is given a stress? Why we are discussing this thing? Why reading? It's a very simple thing. Why reading? To get the information or knowledge. Number two, when we read, we come across number of difficult words. So when we read, we came across a number of words, difficult words. So in that way, we refer to the dictionary. We get the meaning of those words. In this way, reading helps us to develop the vocabularies. Sometimes it helps us to learn or establish grammatical rules. We have learned the rules, but while reading, we can come across why this grammatical rule is used. Let us take one example. If I am taking the example, how through the reading we can learn the grammatical rules. Like, he went to the school. He went to the school. Or he, you can take Ramdas, went to the school. I went to school, not the school. But Ramdas went to the school. The is used. And the, in the second sentence, the is not used. Why? Through the reading, we come across that the is used because Mr. Ramdas is not concerned generally for the school. Ramdas went to the school to speak to the headmaster. Ramdas went to the school to speak to the headmaster. It means it is not concerned with the primary purpose of going to school. I am going to school. What for? Because my primary aim is to teach. So when we go for the primary purpose, we do not make use of article the. But Ramdas went to the school to speak to the headmaster. It means that other than primary purpose. So when we read this thing, why the is used, why the is not used, we learn the grammatical rules. So reading help us in that way to learn grammatical rules. Or whatever the grammatical rules we have learned, it will be established when we read. We remember, why the is used here, why the is not used here. Reading also help us to develop the speed of reading and also the skill of reading. Speed of skill reading, as we know that some people learn 200 pages novels within 2 hours, but there are poor reader like me who takes a week to read a 200 pages novel. Why? The speed of reading. Speed of reading is very slow. So with the help of regular reading practice, we can develop the speed of reading. And also, I say that develop the skill of reading. How to skip, how to jump over. When we find something, unnecessary descriptions are there, we can skip and move forward to the next point. So we develop reading skills through develop these skills through regular practice, skills of reading and speed of reading. Reading also help us to establish the vocabularies already learned. Like there are many vocabularies which I learned, I refer to dictionary for the meaning 1 month or 2 months before. But now when I find this, so I remember, oh, the meaning of this word is that, I refer to this. So it will establish the vocabularies already learned. Reading is important because further education depend upon us. The quality and quantity of reading, for that further education depend on us. Through the reading, we learned the pronunciation of the words. What is the correct pronunciation? INDICT. INDICT. How do I pronounce? It is indite, not the indict, as we generally pronounce. Word stress. We learned this word stress. As we know that English is a stress time language. Some part of the words are said with greater breath force than the other one. Like N-E-G-A-T-I-V-E. N-E-G-A-T-I-V-E. How do I pronounce? Negative or negative? Now we have to learn this thing. How do I learn? Through the reading. Yes, of course, by oral reading. So, negative. Not negative. It is negative. Now the intonation parts. In a sentence, some parts of the words are said with or given importance. So, this one is important. It shows the intonation. How the intonation changes the meaning also. So, when we are reading aloud or reading orally, we have to know the intonation patterns. We have to learn the intonation pattern. I will take three examples for this. It will show how the oral reading, this intonation will help us. How the meaning change. Please listen to me. I saw a tiger. I saw a tiger. Sentence number one. I am repeating twice for you. I saw a tiger. Clear? Number two. I am pronouncing for you twice. I saw a tiger. I saw a tiger. Number three. I saw a tiger. I saw a tiger. Now three sentences, and if you listen carefully, the intonation makes difference. Intonation is packed in different stress and gives different meaning. How? In the first one, I say I saw a tiger, not the goat. It means I saw a tiger, not the goat. Number two, I saw a tiger. Stress on intonation is on saw, not touch. I saw a tiger, not I touched the tiger. Third one is I saw a tiger, none other than I saw a tiger. So the intonation pattern is very important when we read orally or read aloud. So, and the last one, why reading? Because where there is little reading, there is little learning. A popular saying is this. So, why reading? To get the information or knowledge, we can develop vocabulary, we can learn the grammatical rules, we can establish the vocabulary already learned. The quality and quantity of education depend on the reading. We can learn the pronunciation, we can learn the stress patterns, we can learn the intonation patterns. And the most popular thing is, where there is little reading, there is little learning. Now let us talk about the oral and silent reading. Oral reading. What is oral reading? It is an act of reading printed or written text aloud. Here, generally in elementary level, we have to adopt this type of reading strategy, oral reading. Act of reading printed or written text with aloud. We have to get the phoneme, the smallest utterance of a word, a sound pattern, the combination, their combination, phonemes, their combination, the stress and intonation patterns correctly, which can be done, which can be learned with the help of regular oral practice. We have to develop the accuracy through the reading aloud, the pronunciation of course, and also the fluency in reading. The most important thing is the understanding the punctuation marks. While reading aloud, where to stop, where to pause, all these things, where to exclaim, where to interrogate, all these punctuation marks, and of course comprehension. Whenever we read, reading means with understanding. Reading always involves comprehension, and also though in oral reading, the most important thing is to develop facial expression and modulation of the voices. And especially when we are reading the poems or the dramas, or when the dialogues are there, the modulation of voice is very must. So oral reading, act of reading printed or written text aloud. What do we get? We get the phonemes, information about the phonemes, about the combination, about the stress, about the intonation patterns. We can develop the accuracy. We can get the pronunciation correct way, fluency, understanding the punctuation marks, comprehension, then develop the facial expression and modulation of the voices, then the silent reading. What is silent reading? Silent reading means reading silently for greater emphasis on comprehension, whereas in oral reading, greater emphasis on how we read with accuracy, that is why good pronunciation. So the focus is on pronunciation in oral reading, whereas in silent reading the focus is on comprehension, understanding the meaning. In silent reading, physical and psychological activities are there. Physical activities means recognition of the printed words, then how these words are connected with the other words. When we are reading silently, it is not necessary that we know all the words, meaning of all the words associated with it. Sometimes we guess. So how to guess the meaning of unknown words with the help of this thing? So physical activities, eye span, recognition of the words or printed symbols, and also the psychological activities. How? When we read, we have to remember the earlier things what we read. So psychological activities, memory. We have to concentrate what we are reading. We have to bear the other barriers also, like the noises. We have to concentrate. We have to not to divert from the barriers. And we have to read a number of words in a quick succession. And also we have to decode this thing. The written things which are given in a printed form, we have to decode them. The meaning, what is the meaning of these words? So visual perception is important, discrimination of one word from the other one, one sound from the other one, these things are involved here. How the structure of this sentence pattern is different from the earlier one. So all these things here, the in silent reading, the individual, these are individual works. So three characteristics are involved here in silent reading. Number one, span of recognition, duration of fixation, how much time we need for to get the fixation duration. Then also the eye movement is also important. To move forward, eye movements are very important. So these things are there. Now silent reading, why silent reading? It provides definitely greater insight. We can develop the speed of reading here, and also we learn the skill of reading. We can develop the vocabulary as we already discussed, and we can develop the eye span and eye pauses, etc. So we read silently for these purposes. Now the training of eye movements. At the initial stage, we need some training for the eye movements, like now see here. Some books we can see here, they are written with some columns like this. The columns are there. These are the columns. Now see here, I am showing you the newspaper. The columns are there. Some initial books at elementary level, they are written with columns. How? Why they are written with columns? Because they help us for eye fixation. because earlier the little learner, they are not able to span, I span on the full sentences, and therefore this column reading help them for the fixation, I fixation per line. Otherwise what will happen, they are not able to read the line by line. Sometimes they skip one line and they read the other line. So these things are very important. So training of eye movements are very important, and therefore we will see that at the earlier elementary level, the printed matter or the letter size is big, the bigger than the normal size. So the eye span, these things are very important. So column reading, we can say column reading column reading is very important. Like here, number two, here training of eye movements, we have to keep number one column reading for eye movement. Number two, sometimes to help the reader, what we do is to underline the key words in the passage for their eye, focusing on eyes. So important words are underlined so they understand what is the meaning of this passage with greater speed. I am showing one example, please bear with me and see this example. I am showing this thing for you. See here, I'm quickly reading out to you. See here, it was a hot afternoon and the railway carriage was correspondently sultry, and the next stop was at Temple Combe, nearly an hour ahead. The occupants of the carriage were a small girl and a small boy. An aunt belonging to the children occupied one corner seat, and the further corner seat on the opposite side was occupied by a bachelor who was a stranger to the party. But the small girl and the small boy emphatically occupied the compartment. This is there, and you see the next line here. This one. You see this paragraph. See here, it was a hot afternoon, means the main words are underlined here, which help them to comprehend. So when we underline, it helps them to focus their eye span. Now in silent reading, what happened, there are, when we read any text, we come across the initial stage some words which never came across to us, means they are sent as unknown words. So generally for the beginners, we have to use such text material where the known vocabularies and known grammatical structures are used, which help them to read for enjoyment. So when unfamiliar words are there, every year we read at least 300 new words, some words which they have learned earlier, some words they have to learn this year, and there are some words which they just know the meaning of the words, not necessary that they use the they are able to use that word in a day-to-day life. So on the basis of certain criteria, we divide the vocabularies into two categories: active vocabularies and passive vocabularies. First of all, passive vocabularies. What is passive vocabulary? Those words which come across, which entered in our textbook less number of times, which occurred occasionally in our lesson, they come under the category of passive vocabulary. Means there are number of occurrences less, they will create less trouble to the students or the learner. But knowing the meaning of those words are important. So their frequency is less. We think that as a teacher that they are less useful. Sometimes we think that they are above the level of the learner. Means there are certain words which we think that according to the level of the learner, these words are not used. So according to the three criteria, number one, frequency, number of frequency is less, number of means usefulness is less, and they are above the level of the learner. We keep these three points for selecting this into PSC vocabulary. Number two is active vocabulary. What are active vocabulary? Which occurred number of times in a lesson. When the words are occurring number of times, means we have to teach those words very importantly, because otherwise they will create the problem for the learners. So number one, when the occurrence is, the frequency of the words is more, we find that they are according to the learner level of the learner. We assume that the student of class 10 must know these words. So level of the learner, and they are useful. These words are used in day-to-day life, though these words come under the active vocabulary. Which word come under the active vocabulary? Frequency is more, they are useful, they are according to the level of the learner. Now when we use this passive vocabulary or active vocabulary, we have to teach 3 S of a word. 3 S. What are the 3 S of a word? Number one is the sound. First S is sound. What is the sound of the word? Means what is the pronunciation of a word? Number two, what is the shape? Shape means the spelling. What is the spelling of a word? Number three S is sense. What is the sense? Sense means meaning of a word. So whenever we are teaching any vocabulary or any unfamiliar words, we have to teach 3 S of a word. What are the 3 S of a word? Number one, sound means the pronunciation. Number two, shape, what is the spelling. Number three, what is the sense means meaning. What is the pronunciation, sound pattern. Okay, examination, how do I pronounce this word? Examination, where is the stress? Number two, the spelling, some confusing spelling. Receive, receive or receive, which one is correct? So we write those words on a blackboard to make the spelling clear to our learners. So this is a shape. Number three, sense means meaning. Whenever we teach the meaning of words, the meaning of the words are taught in a meaningful context, not in isolation. Like, take one example. Characters, what is the meaning of character? Arre, character ka matlab charitra. Generally we say character means charitra. In isolation we are teaching, we are giving the word and the meaning. But see the context. He has a weak character. Character, meaning of character here. The characters of Shakespeare's novels are very true to life. The characters of Shakespeare novels are very true to life. Now, suppose the student has asked the second sentence. He is asking the meaning of a second sentence where the character is used. So the charitra meaning is quite not applicable there. So whenever we teach the meaning of a word, it must not be taught in isolation but in context. Let us take one example of current. CURRENT. There is no current. The current of this river is very fast. In current political situation, there is no alternative of this government. please bear with me. It is not political. I am just taking an example. So use of current here. There is no current. The current of this river is very fast. In the current political situation, there is no alternative of this government. Three sentences and the meaning of current. So according to the context, the meaning differ. So whenever we teach the meaning of a words, we must teach in context. And we have to teach 3 S of the words. When we are teaching the student silent reading, we know that some psychological factors are also there in early stage of reading. Means there are some reverse images are there. We form a reverse message, learner form a reverse messages, and there are some mistakes like S-A-W, saw is pronounced or read as W-A-S, was. Sometimes O and on is read as N-O, no. So like this are there. So when we are developing reading, silent reading skill, we have to focus on this thing. Number one, silent reading means it will help in greater comprehension. But it, so reverse images are there. We have to keep this thing in mind. Whenever we teach the difficult words in a meaningful situation, we have to use, we have to teach the 3 S of a word. The 3 S of a word are sound, shape and sense. Means the pronunciation, the shape means the spelling, and the meaning. And meaning is always in context. Now the skimming and scanning. Skimming, these terms are new. Skimming and scanning. When we want to see in day-to-day life, we are doing these activities in number of in daily life, skimming and scanning. When we want to get overall idea of the passage, suppose we are reading a newspaper. When we read a newspaper, when we a hawker deliver a newspaper in our home, what we do? We read the headlines quickly. We read the headlines before focusing our reading. Before focusing our reading on a particular news, we read the headlines of the newspaper. This initial survey of the newspaper or reading is called skimming, to get the main points. And then when we focus our attention on a specific, we read with greater speed. Means we want to get the supporting details in a quickest possible time. So skimming is a fast reading, and when we want to get an overall idea of the passage, we adopt skimming strategies. Suppose when we are given some letters, and so what we do? We do not read with very slowly, but we read very fast to know what is this letter about. So this initial reading is called skimming. One point here I would like to just share with our teacher colleague, that when we read the first language, we do not adopt, we adopt this type of reading strategies, means skimming and scanning in first when we are reading mother tongue or Hindi. But when we are reading second language or any foreign language, we adopt one type of reading strategies only, and that is intensive reading. What is intensive reading? We will come across later, but I am just sharing this. We adopt slow and careful reading strategy, because each word, each line, each sentence is very important. So intensive reading. In second reading, in second language, we adopt only one type of reading, and that is intensive reading. But through the practice, if we practice it, we can adopt different reading strategies like skimming and scanning, all these things. So skimming is to set the overall ideas of the passage, reading the newspaper. We adopt this type of things in a day-to-day life, like before buying a book from the bookshop, what we do? We make initial survey. We just turn on the pages and we say, no, give me the next one. So to get the this thing, initial survey is called the overall ideas, skimming is there. Number two is scanning. We scan to look at the specific information. Suppose we are referring to the dictionary. What is the meaning of palpitate? We are referring to the dictionary for specific purpose, specific word, that is palpitate. How this word, what is the meaning of this word? We are very specific. So when we are looking for any specific information, we are doing scanning. We are adopting scanning reading strategies. Index of the book, like this book is there, and the index, these are the indexes, number one, page number, like this. So scanning is for specific information. Number three is intensive reading. Generally, intensive reading is used when we are reading our textbook, which are prescribed in our syllabus. For that, we are using intensive reading strategies, because we want that it should, all the words, all the lines are very important. We adopt very slow and careful reading strategies to understand the full text with greater comprehension, means more than 80 to 90% comprehension should be done. So intensive reading, we want to get full information, greater comprehension, and we adopt slow and careful reading strategies for this. Number four is extensive reading. When we want to get just develop a reading competency, we want to get the main idea, at that time we adopt extensive reading. Like when we are reading novels or any fiction, so at that time, or when we are reading supplementary readers, at that time we adopt extensive reading, and the purpose of extensive reading is to develop reading habits among learners. So four different types of readings are there. Skimming, when we want to get overall idea of the passage, when we are reading newspaper for the first time, initial survey. Number two, scanning, when we want to get the specific information, referring to dictionary or index of the book, very specific. Intensive reading, when we want to get the full information, especially when we are reading our textbook, which are prescribed in the syllabus, when we want to get the full information. Extensive reading, when we want to get the main ideas only. And now, when we have to remember that when these things are there, like in intensive reading and extensive reading, main textbook and reading for the pleasure, means extensive reading or supplementary readers, at that time when we frame the questions, the purpose, because the purpose of these textbooks are different, so we have to test according to that objectives. Intensive reading, textbook reading, when we want to get full information, so there, when we ask questions based on those content, we have to ask in-depth question. When we are teaching, we have taught supplementary readers, the purpose is extensive reading. So here, general or local questions are asked. These things we have to keep in mind. Now, reading for different purposes. What are the purposes of reading? Study reading. When study reading is there, like the matter is very difficult here, material is very difficult, and high degree of comprehension is required. Or the speed of reading is 200 to 250 words per minute, and with greater comprehension, means more than 80 to 90% comprehension. At that time, we adopt study reading strategies. Average reading strategies, when we read newspaper, magazine, novels, and other easier text, the word per minute is also more, 250 to 300 words per minute, but the comprehension is less, 70% comprehension. Skimming and scanning, fastest form of reading, words per minute is about 800 words per minute, but the comprehension must not be lower than the 50%. So study reading, average reading, and skimming and scanning. So this one is the faster reading. Now, levels of comprehension. Reading the lines, number one. When we read the any text, we want to get the objective facts but also the subjective information. So we adopt different types of we read, and we are being tested through different levels of comprehension. Reading the lines means when we test only the literal meaning of the familiar words, and also the inferring meaning of unfamiliar words or from the contextual tools. So reading the lines involves literal meaning, familiar words, inferring the meaning of unfamiliar words from the contextual tools. Reading the lines. Reading between the lines, second one is, means reading beyond the understanding, just literal meaning, means beyond the literal meaning. Here we want to know what is the author's intent, what is the purpose, and we interpret wherever is necessary. The third one is reading beyond the lines. Number one is reading the lines. Number two is reading between the lines. Number three is reading beyond the lines, means making critical evaluation. What is being read? What is the implication of this after reading? Speculation about the consequences, and drawing generalization, which is not stated by the author, and ideas arranged into certain patterns. So reading beyond the lines. And the fourth one is reading with involvement. Here, in this type of reading with involvement, reader reaches the highest and most complete level of comprehension, and he or she identifies himself or herself with the character and sympathizes with them. And sometimes, and therefore, reading with involvement for this purpose only, to develop greater values among learners, we prescribe the autobiography of great personalities, where we want that this reading should involve some values, and these values can be developed by reading this thing. So for the levels of comprehension, reading the lines, when we are we want to get the literal meaning, reading between the lines, reading beyond the understanding, just literal meaning, means when we want to get the author's intent, what is the purpose, and interpretation. Reading beyond the lines makes the critical evaluation, what is being read, implications, what are the consequences, drawing generalization, and also the arranging the ideas. Reading with involvement means that when we want to get the highest level of comprehension, and we identify the character and sympathize with him. So these are the things. Now there are 15 more minutes are there, and you have to bear with me. I am going to show you some of the activities which we can do, these activities for developing our reading skills among the learners. So I am showing you some of the pictures. Please check it, that this will be visible to you. I am making this thing to you. Activities: reordering the sequence of pictures. These are the pictures, and reordering the sequence of pictures here. Actually, this is not a test. I'm just sharing that what can be done. We all are teachers, and this is one means I propose this type of activities. If you are agree, you can share this thing in your class. So just to make known to you about the different types of activities we can organize, I am giving this thing to you. So reordering the sequence, the sequences are given in different patterns, and we have to organize this thing. Number two is relate text with pictures. Now see here. Relate text with pictures. Text are there: cards, hockey, cricket, kabaddi, badminton, football, basketball, volleyball, and tennis, and
we have to relate the text with the help of pictures. I am moving forward. Now see here, the matching.
Matching. I am showing you here only. See here. This one is matching. What we can do, we can separate the headlines of any news headlines, and these are the news, and we can ask the students to read this text and relate with the headings. So with the help of regular practice, they can develop the speed and skill of reading, how to read the text and also the headlines with it. So we can do this thing by looking this newspaper also. Like these are the news headlines, and we can separate these news and we can give them in a number to the students, and they can read quickly this headings and the news and tell it this, what is this news about, what will be the heading. So these things can be done. Next exercise is completing a documents. Picture is there. I'm sorry if it is not visible to you. I'm sorry. I'm just giving you the ways through which we can develop the reading. Completing a document, a picture is there. And with the help of picture, we have to interpret what is that picture about. And then we have to fill in the blanks. I can see a dash in the picture. Two boys are dashed from the bus like this. Completing a documents. Then a mapping, a passage is there. With the help of this passage, we have to draw a picture. A big fruit basket is lying on the table. Means we have to draw the table, and on the table we have to draw a basket. There are four bananas and three apples in the basket. Means we have to draw that thing. So like this, we can develop the proper understanding of the learner, what they have read, where they have to, where they have understood or not. Means the use of in and on. Like this, I'm just moving forward because time is stand there. Comparing the text, please focus this thing, please bear with me because this is very important. Comparing the text. Now please see here, we will give some time on this text. There are two passages actually. I am showing the passage number one. Please see this, or just I am sharing, I am reading for you to make you the things easy for you. There are three major types of headaches. They are caused by high blood pressure, energy and sinus, pain in the forehead, sweating, anxiety, nauseous, vomiting and confusing are the major symptoms of high blood pressure headache. Pressure on means high blood pressure headache. Pressure on both sides of the head, in the forehead and behind the eye. Sneezing and watery eyes are the symptoms of allergy headache. Sinus headache may be centered on frontal sinuses when the pain is felt in the forehead. Temples and eyes are in the maxillary sinuses when pain is located in the face, forehead and upper jaw. Just see this and compare this text with this one. Sorry if this is, see here, now I am reading for you. There are three major types of headache. These are headaches caused by high blood pressure, the symptoms of which are pain in forehead, sweating, anxiety, nauseous, vomiting and confusion. The second type of headache is the allergy headache, the symptoms of which are pressure on both sides of the head like this. So now let us compare this. I am making easy for you this one. Now if we compare A with B, A is say that there are three major types of headache. These are caused by high blood pressure, energy and sinuses. Means three types of headaches are there and they are mentioned. These are caused by high blood pressure, energy and sinus. And then the symptoms are given. Whereas in the second B, if you see, three major types of headache, these are headaches caused by high blood pressure and then symptoms. Means in the first one, in A, three types of headaches are given and these are caused by high blood pressure, energy and sinus, and after that their symptoms are given. Whereas in the B, here B, each type of headache is given and after that the symptoms are given. So we can give this type of text with a different types of writing style, and we ask them to compare. Here three types of headaches are given and then their symptoms are given, whereas in B the three types of headaches, every type of headaches, and after that the symptoms are given. So the comparing the text. Now reorganizing the information. Now some activities are there. Means actually this is how to prepare a paper in a factory. This is there, and the actions are given here, and we can ask our students to reorganize the information. Like it is also chemically bleached to whiten it. But we have to remember, when we are giving this type of information to test or reorganize the information, our students must have some information about that. Because sometimes the scientific information cannot be tested on the arts students, because they are not lacking the language here. The language is not tested here. But we are testing the scientific facts, where the students are unaware of that. So we have to keep in mind what type of exercises we have to frame. So reorganizing the information. Now see, complete our documents. Monster of the past. Here the different monsters are there, and of that there is a text. After reading this, I am not asking you to read this thing, just to know what type of exercises we can develop in the classroom for developing our reading skills among the learners. So these are the master of the parts. We ask our students to complete the task based on this. They will read the passage, this one, and they will complete the table. This one is table. This one is the table here. Complete the table. Name of the dinosaurs here. How do they appear? Their special features and the nature. And these are the nature. We are asking these things. So after reading this one, like the first one I am reading. Brontosaur. The thunder lizard weighed as much as 10 elephants and probably sounded like thunder when it walked, but it ate only plants. Now when we use this brontosaur here, how do they appear? Very big and heavy. Few elephants. Special feature is they weigh as much 10 elephants and sounded like thunder when it walked. And what is the nature? Nature is they are vegetable. They ate only plants. So nature is they are vegetarian. So if we can develop our reading skill of our learners by adopting this type of reading strategies. Now, interpretation. How do we interpret? Now, I've taken example of a railway timetable is there. I'm reading for you. Name of train is there. Arrival time in New Delhi. Departure time from New Delhi. And platform number is there. Rajdhani Express from Delhi to Mumbai. 10 a.m. 4:30 a.m. Platform number 3. Shatabdi Express. 7 p.m. 6 a.m. Platform number 5. Jammu Tawi Express. 6 a.m. 10. Like this information is given. And now the questions. Based on this, we have to interpret. The information is given there. How to interpret? This timetable is put up at dash railway station. If you read the passage here, the timetable at New Delhi railway station. So means they will read, they will understand and interpret the information, and they will put here. This timetable is put up at New Delhi railway station. So in this way, comprehend the text through interpretation. There are many exercises based on this. I'm moving forward. Distinguishing between related words and ideas. This is the passage. I am first focusing on the passage. It is a very lengthy passage. Sorry. But because I find this passage is very interesting to test the words and ideas which confuse us. So we have to select such activities where the students find it difficult, like cause and result. What is the cause here and what is the result? What is the cause and what is the result here? So if you read the text, this whole text, you will find out Rahul was upset. Why Rahul was upset? What is this? Whether it is a cause or result? Rahul didn't find his pen in the morning. Rahul couldn't sleep. The teacher scolded Rahul. So we have to divide this into cause and result after reading this thing. If we want to establish cause and effect words among the students to make the words clear to our students, then we can take this type of exercises. I am moving forward. Question answer. Generally, for reading, we take this thing, and I will take some time for this, because this one is generally when we teach reading, we generally take this type of exercises. We generally frame this type of exercises only. So here is a passage for you, and I will need some time to concentrate you. I request all of you to concentrate on this because sometimes it creates the problems. So I am reading for you. Just Gregory is about 45 and his hair is starting to grow gray. Typographical mistakes, two words are printed there. Everybody knows Gregory because he reads the news on television. He has done his this for 10 years and enjoys it very much. He likes it when people stop him in the street, or when they point at him and whisper to their friends. Yesterday, his boss suggested Gregory change his job. Gregory knows his boss wants a younger man to take his place and doesn't care what happened to him. The new job could never be as good as this old one. He has no one to discuss the problem with at home, and this makes it worse. Now, after reading this passage, we can frame the questions, and I have framed the questions also. So let us see what type of questions we can do. Number one is generally we ask literal questions. Literal questions are those questions where we accept responses as directly stated in the text. We can take the answer directly from the text itself. So it is a literal questions. Means like we ask here, here you can see. Like after reading here, see, what is Gregory's job? What is Gregory's job? And if we see the Gregory's job here, what is Gregory's job? So Gregory's job, he reads news on television. So the factual information, literal expression is there. We can get this thing from the text itself. Number two, let us this exercises are there. Inferential, inferential generally we avoid true and false type of, but here I have this one is frame. Gregory is likely to lose his job. Inferent, we have to infer this thing. This thing we have to conclude. The responses are indirectly stated, and we require some other information for this. So inferential type of comprehension. And number three is evaluative type of questions. Evaluative responses based on reader's opinion. So on reader's opinion, we ask, what do you think Gregory will do? Means the boss is asked to that he will retire, he will select some other person for in place of Gregory. So here your judgment is required. What do you think Gregory will do? Had you been in place of Gregory, what have you done? So this type of comprehension questions are evaluative comprehension. So mainly in English, at school level, we focus first, the focus is on literal, where we directly stated responses we take, inferential, where the responses are indirectly stated and it require other information, evaluative responses based on reader's opinion. So these three types of comprehension generally we take to make to test our comprehension level of the learner. I'm moving forward. Note making, this is also very important. To test whether the students are able to find out the main points and supporting details after reading the text or not. So the text is here, reading aloud text is here, and on the basis of that text, notes are there. When we prepare the notes, why note making is put up in this lecture? Because for note making we require to find out the main points and what are the supporting details. If we are a very good reader, we can then identify what are the main points in the paragraph and what are the supporting details are there in the paragraph. So the notes are there, reading aloud, these are the paragraphs. These paragraphs are there, this is the paragraph. And the notes are there, reading aloud, these are the thing. And mind it, these notes are the format is called verbal format. See here, verbal format. Point number one, this one is point number one here, and this one is point number two. So just giving you the idea what type of exercises we can frame. So note making also, and after the note making, if if the students have understand the things properly, they are able to find out the main points and supporting details. So on the basis of reading, they can develop a summary also based on any passage. Means after reading any text, after reading any lesson, or based on lesson, they can frame note making either verbal format, and after that they can prepare a summary based on that passage. We are moving towards the last point now, the information transfer. How the reading help us in information transfer. Now if we read this passage, this is passage about the how the potato cake is prepared. So these are the processes: peel the and slice potatoes, boil with a bit of salt, then mash boiled potatoes, mix it with this one. So this is a process based on any content. According to the content, we can frame a process part. Like suppose we have given any technical text to our students, like how the steel is prepared, how the steel is prepared, how the iron is prepared from the iron ore. So there is a process. Or you can say how to prepare tea. How to prepare tea? At that time the process is there. Take a bowl, put some water in it like this. So there will be a process. Means through this information transfer, before information transfer, we have to, the student has to identify what are the main points and how one main points support the another one. So this one is a information transfer, and this information transfer and the format used is a process. Another information transfer is malaria is transmitted by mosquitoes called anopheles. And through this text, now see here, we cannot adopt the process here because this one is a life cycle. We do not know the which one is the starting point, which one is the end point. So based on the text, we have to select the different formats. Like here, the life cycle. Earlier one was the process, where there is one starting point and one end point. Here there is, we are not sure which one is the starting point, which one is the end point, so we are taking this one. Other one, we can take different types of format, like some information can be transferred to table format or tree diagram like this, based on the content. Now the towards the end, while reading, what are the things we have to keep in mind while reading? When we are reading, we have to keep many things in mind while developing reading skills. Number one, we have to avoid use of pen and pencil, because pen and pencil hinder the line, hinder the word, and which create a confusion of spelling errors, punctuation marks, etc. So whenever we read, whenever our learners are reading, make an initial survey how they are reading, and we ask them to avoid use of pen and pencil and fingers under the words when they are reading. Number two, lip movement. They must not... Number two is lip movement. We have to avoid the lip movement. Some people are, when reading silently, they read like this, which we have to avoid this thing. Number three is the head movement. When we read, we make head movement like this. So there must not be head movement, what we call it as a head wagging. H-E-A-D-W-A-G-G-I-N-G. Head wagging. There are sometimes sub-vocalization. Sub-vocalization means you can say unclear sounds, unclear sound, or mumbling. Mumbling means the whispering. There must not be whisper. When we are reading aloud, means that we have to read aloud, that should be audible to all the learners. And there must not be regression. Regression means backward movement. What I have read earlier, we have to turn the pages sometimes. When the reader is poor reader, when he or she is not a good reader, he forget what was discussed earlier. So we have to avoid the regression. So there are number of things we have to remember. Number one is we have to avoid use of pen, pencil and fingers when we are reading. There is no lip movement. There is no sub-vocalization. There is no head movement like this. There is no regression. And these are the things we have to keep in mind. Let us sum up this thing. What are the things we discuss here? We discuss number one, language skills. Number two, what is reading? Why reading? Then we discuss oral and silent reading. Then how the training of eyes movements can be done. Vocabulary, how to teach the vocabulary, we have to remember the three S of a word. The scheming is scanning. Reading for different purposes. What are the different levels of comprehension? Then we discuss the activities. What are the different activities we are supposed to organize in the classroom? Like number one, reordering the sequence of pictures. We discuss the text and pictures, the matching, completing a document, then mapping, comparing the text, reorganizing the information, completing the documents, interpretation, words and ideas, question and answer is of course there, how to make notes based on our reading, then summary, then information transfer, and the most important thing, what are the points to remember while developing reading skill among the learners. At the end, I must thanks my sincere thanks to Dr. Somu Singh for giving and this opportunity to me to share my experiences with you. Thank you, Somu Singh, and I know how hard you work for this thing. I just salute to you. Because of your only efforts, we are able to share this thing, and you have joined so many participants under your banner. Thanks a lot. Thanks to your hard work, I salute to you. Thanks to all the participants who are joined this Facebook live program. Thank you very much. Thank you very much again.